Welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anurekha Chariwag, Assistant Professor, Department of Sociology, Savitri Bai Phule, Pune University. I am coordinating the paper on Sociology in India. Today, we are going to discuss the module Nation Nationality and Nation Building in India. This module has been written by Professor Chandan Kumar Sharma, Department of Sociology, Tezpur University. This module is going to discuss the issues regarding nation-state and nation-building, especially the challenges of regional identities and linguistic states towards this whole idea of nation-building in India. The module will also discuss the rise of politics in regionalism. The objectives. 1. To understand the various interpretations pertaining to the concept of nation and nationality. 2. To understand the nature of Indian nation and the process of nation building in India. Introduction. Defining the concept. Defining nation, nationality or nationalism is a complicated exercise. These terms are often used to imply a multiplicity of interrelated phenomena leading to their ambivalence. One reason for such ambivalence is that they all have the origin in the same Latin word natio, which implies birth or descent. A dominant view in the past was that to become a nation, a people sharing common race, language, religion must live together in a geographical area. However, this view does not have much currency now. The generally accepted view today holds that rather than sharing attributes like common race, language, religion, it is a sentiment of a common consciousness that forms the basis of a nation. A nation has a political meaning which is distinct from a nationality. A nationality is transformed into a nation when it organizes a state or at least cherishes a common will to live together in a state for the future. When the territorial boundary of a state is coterminous with the cultural, linguistic and ethnic division of the people, the nation within it, it becomes a nation state which is different from the state forms, for example, the empires of the earlier times, which constituted more than one and often several national groups. The concept of nation state is based on the concept of one nation, one state, became a dominant mode of the state forms in Western Europe. This also subsequently came to form the nation building projects of the newly independent states in various parts of the world. But the problems emerged as most of these countries were multinational in nature, incorporating several nations or groups with near nation status. Empirical experiences have shown that there rarely exists a country in the modern world where one nation, one state model can be observed. On the contrary, one witnesses not only several nations within the territorial boundary of a single state, but also a single nation spreading over more than one state. For example, the United Kingdom, Russian Federation, India, the United States of America are examples of multinational states, while Kurds, the Tamils, the Hazaras are examples of trans-state nations, implying that they are spread over more than one state. Historian Eric Hobsbawm writes that nations, contrary to popular belief, are not as old as history. The modern sense of the world is no longer than the 18th century. He admits that what characteristics classify a group of human beings as a nation is difficult to answer. Nevertheless, he points out that attempts have been made to establish objective criteria for defining a nation based on a single criteria such as language or ethnicity, or a combination of criteria such as language, common territory, common history, cultural traits, or whatever else. But all such objective definitions have failed because only some members of the large class of entities which fit such definitions can at any time be described as nations. The exceptions are there. Hobsbawm also shows that the criteria used for this purpose, language, ethnicity or whatever, are themselves fuzzy, shifting and ambiguous. Sociologist T.K. Ooman offers what he calls some tentative definitional proposals of a nation nationality, state citizenship and ethnic ethnicity. In his definition, the nation is a territorial entity to which the nationals have an emotional attachment and in which they invest a moral meaning. It is a homeland, ancestral or adopted. The state, on the other hand, is a legally constituted institution which provides its residents with protection from internal insecurity and external aggression. Making the distinction between the state and the nation, he says that while territory is common to both, there is a crucial difference between national territory and the state territory. Former is a moral and the latter is a legal entity. If the state and the nation are coterminous, we have a nation state. But most states today are multinational, polyethnic, or a combination of the two. He then goes on to say that for the sustenance of the nation, the people should be in a position to communicate with one another. That is, they should have a common language. However, it is not the case that all those who communicate in the same language necessarily make a nation. It is a combination, the fusion of territory and language that makes a nation. A nation in a community, in communication in its homeland. Thus, according to women, a common homeland and a common language, ancestral or adopted, are the critical minimum markers of a nation and national identity. On the other hand, women defines nationality as a collective identity that people of a nation acquire by identifying with the nation. This view equates nationality with citizenship. However, nationality is often used as a synonym for ethnicity. In this, various cultural groups constituting a nation are described as nationalities. Anthony Smith defines nation as named human population sharing a historic territory, common myths and historical memories, a mass public culture, a common economy and common legal rights and duties for all members. However, Smith's definition of nation is criticized on the ground that it does not distinguish a nation from an ethnic group. Barrington points out that the idea of territory is central to all definitions of a nation and is a distinguishing feature between nation and other social categories such as an ethnic group. According to Barrington, nations are groups of people linked by unifying traits such as myths, values, symbols, etc., and the desire to control a territory that is thought of as a group's national homeland. It is not necessary that they actually control any such territory. He further points out that the word nation is often mistakenly used as synonyms with an ethnic group or ethnicity. However, although a nation can evolve from an ethnic group, it is more than an ethnic group because of its belief in its right to territorial control. More importantly, nations need not be based on certain ethnic identity. For example, the American nation is not based on any shared ethnic identity, although the Americans share certain cultural features such as origin myths and symbols and language. Emphasizing the difficulty in offering a stable definition of the nation, historian Prasenjit Dohra writes, "The instability of the concept of nation is such that we are unable to say whether it is in ascendancy or in decline. The definitional ambiguities associated with the term nation have its own impact on the conceptualization of the term nationalism. It is pointed out that the definition of nationalism reveals more about the definers than about the defined. Under such situation, to accept a consensus on contested political realities or a single overarching paradigm explanatory of all manifestations of national phenomena is illusory, at least for the time being." Renowned theorist of nationalism Benedict Anderson contends that nationality, nationness, as well as nationalism are cultural artifacts of a particular kind. They are notoriously difficult to define, let alone analyze. He argues that a nation is an act of imagination by underlying the fact that nations were not the determinate products of some given sociological conditions like language or race or religion, that they had been imagined onto existence. He also describes some of the major institutional forms through which this imagined community comes to acquire concrete shape. He further emphasizes that the 20th century nationalism and nation states have a profoundly modular character. Historical experience of nationalism in the West provided all subsequent nationalisms with a set of modular forms from which nationalist elites in Asia and Africa had chosen the ones they liked. Balibar writes that he and Immanuel Wallerstein consider nation and people as historical constructs by means of which current institutions and antagonisms can be projected into the past to confer a relative stability on the communities on which the sense of individual identity depends, according to them. No nation, that is, no national state, has an ethnic basis, which means that nationalism cannot be defined as an ethnocentrism except precisely in the sense of the product of a fictive ethnicity. To reason any other way would be to forget that peoples do not exist naturally, either by virtue of their ancestry, a community of culture or pre-existing interest. But they have to institute in real and therefore in historical time the imaginary unity against other possible unities. Balibar further writes that the term fiction should not be taken in the sense of a pure and simple illusion without historical effect. As he contends, no nation possesses an ethnic base naturally, but as social formations are nationalized, the populations included within them, divided up among them or dominated by them are ethnicized, that is, represented in the past or in the future as if they form a national community possessing of itself an identity of origins, culture and interest which transcends individuals and social conditions. According to social anthropologist and political philosopher Ernest Gellner, nationalism is primarily a political principle, he emphasizes, which holds that the political and the national units should be congruent. He further writes, "Nations like states are a contingency and not a universal necessity." Explaining the relationship between nationality or ethnicity and nationalism, Gellner has this to say, "Ethnicity or nationality is simply the name for the condition which prevails when many of these boundaries converge and overlap, so that The boundaries of conversation, easily commensality, shared pastimes are the same, and when the community of the people delimited by these boundaries are endowed with an ethnonym, it is suffused with powerful feelings. Ethnicity becomes political. It gives rise to nationalism when the ethnic group defined by these overlapping cultural boundaries is not merely acutely conscious of its own existence, but also imbued with a conviction that the ethnic boundary ought also to be a political one. The requirement is that the boundaries of ethnicity should also be the boundaries of the political unit, and above all, that the rulers within that unit should be of the same ethnicity as the ruled. In the preface to his Ethnicity and Nationalism, published in 1991, political theorist Paul Brass states that ethnicity and nationalism are not givens but are social and political constructions. They are created by the elites of ethnic groups with the object of protecting their well-being or existence or to gain political and economic advantage for their groups as well as themselves. He further argues that ethnicity and nationalism are modern phenomena inseparably connected with the activities of the modern centralizing state arising out of specific types of interactions between the leadership of centralizing states and the elites from non-dominant ethnic groups, especially but not exclusively on the peripheries of those states. Brass states that when an ethnic group demands a major say for the group in the political system as a whole, or control over a piece of territory within the country, or they demand a country of their own with full sovereignty, with an aspiration to the national status and recognition, and achieves any one of these goals either within an existing state or a state of its own, it becomes a nationality or a nation. From this viewpoint, a nation may be seen as a particular type of ethnic community, or rather as an ethnic community politicized with recognized group rights in the political system. It follows from this that nations may be created by the transformation of an ethnic group in a multi-ethnic state into a self-conscious political entity, or by the amalgamation of diverse groups and the formation of an inter-ethnic composite or homogeneous national culture through the agency of the modern state. Nation-state and national building. When the modern nation-states came into being, especially in Western Europe, the ethnic identities of many of the constituent groups within the nation-states were lying dormant, so much so that their distinct identities were almost ignored. The concept of the nation-state subscribed to a definition of a nation that accords a central place to the idea of the state, in which the term nation was held synonymous with the most dominant group within the so-called nation-state. The idea of working behind this concept of the nation was that the smaller or marginal communities living within a particular nation-state in course of time would assimilate with the dominant group, or else over a period of time would move towards the formation of their own nation-states. It is this perception that has inspired the dominant group within the nation state to assimilate their other smaller constituents in the name of the nation building exercise. In some cases, this exercise achieved relative success depending on the effectiveness of the projects of cultural standardization, argues Barua. But in most of the cases in this project faced serious problem. The dominant groups in these cases carried out their agenda of nation construction through the exercise of their influence in the economic, political, cultural and demographic spheres without taking into consideration the ethos and aspiration of the smaller communities. The concept of nation building thus becomes to be metaphorically described by McCloskey as a handsome neoclassical building in which political prisoners scream in the basement, cited in Barua, which treats people, as Boer states, lifeless bricks to be moved by some master builder. At this stage, it is worthwhile to take note of Wallerstein's observation on the phenomena of nation building. Addressing the question as to why should the establishment of any particular sovereign state within the interstate system create a corresponding nation, a people, he states that it happens as the states in the system have problem of cohesion, as they often face threat of both internal disintegration and external aggression. The creation of a national sentiment reduces such threat. He writes, the government in power has an interest in promoting the sentiment, as do all sorts of subgroups within the state. Any group who sees advantage in using the state's legal powers to advance its interest against groups outside the state or in any sub-region of the state has an interest in promoting national sentiment as a legitimation of its claim. States furthermore have an interest in administrative uniformity that increases the efficacy of their policies. Nationalism is the expression, the promoter and consequences of such state-level uniformities. The attempt at creating such uniformities, however, leads to politico-economic and cultural suppression and and marginalization of the smaller nationalities within these states. This eventually reinforces a sense of separate identity among the latter vis-a-vis the dominant communities as being deprived and repressed. In an attempt to politically mobilize this new identity consciousness against the hegemonic designs of the centralizing state, the elites of the smaller nationalities take recourse to a project of cultural hegemony rooted in their history, partly real but largely imagined, much after the model of the modern state. It is through this process that nationality movements emerge in the modern nation-state. Led by their elites, these movements mobilize themselves asking for more political, economic and cultural rights from the state. The latter naturally attempts to subvert the aspirations of the smaller groups in order to maintain its existing status. This intensifies the political expression of the smaller groups even further. However, the struggle of a nationality group demanding more rights and privileges for itself and its simultaneous interaction with the state does not necessarily lead to the consolidation of its identity. It also often leads to the growth of fissi-paris tendencies, underscoring the existence of cleavages within it. Nation and nation building in India. It has been pointed out that the post-independence Indian state, despite its multi-ethnic character, has been engaged in a project of nation-building which subscribes to the Western notions of nation-state, in which, ideally speaking, language, religion and political sovereignty have coterminous boundaries. Dwelling on the overall nation-building experience in India and other parts of South Asia, Fudnis and Ganguly write, post-colonial nation-building approaches in the region focused mostly exclusively on creating a unified national identity based around either common political values and citizenship or a putative majoritarian ethnic identity. The aim of both approaches on the whole has been to produce a pulverized and uniform sense of national identity to coincide with the nation-state boundaries that seldom reflect ethnic divisions on the ground. This type of outlook towards nation-building, as promoted vigorously by modernization school of thought, refused to accept the notion that states incorporating more than one ethnic nation could be both stable and harmonious. Political scientist Ishtiaq Ahmed, commenting on the nation-building enterprise in the South Asian elites, argues, the elites which took over the power at the time of British withdrawal were compelled by a host of internal and external pressures to reduce or eliminate the incongruence between the state and society, the nation-building process in all. The countries have been confronted by serious separatist challenge. Each case of separatism constitutes a unique specimen of state-society contradiction. This nation-building exercise that the post-independence Indian state adopted with the objective of the construction of pan-Indian identity stood in the way of fulfillment of economic, political and cultural aspirations of various ethnic groups located within its territory, fueling protest movements among them. As Krishna says, whenever the state elites in the region, South Asia, have attempted to ride roughshod over the rights and aspirations of the so-called peripheral minorities, which could be religious, linguistic, regional or the other, the result has been either a violent partition, secession, or that emergence of ethno-nationalist movements that have attempted to achieve those ends. The point finds support in other scholars too. Ghosh and Chakravarti, for example, point out that despite the recognition of the fact that the future survival of the nation-state in India would depend on the acceptance of the plurality of nationalities, there continued to be a strong strain of thought that ought to do away with group identities in the name of national integration, generating a lot of resistance in areas like the northeastern region of the country, cited in Mishra. On the other hand, these groups are also not homogeneous identities. They are often constituted by a number of other small ethnic configurations living in geo-social proximity. The process of formation of a crystallized ethnic identity by incorporating such smaller groups is still operative in several parts of India, especially its northeastern region. It is to be recognized that prior to the establishment of the colonial rule, India did not exist as an integrated politico-territorial entity. There existed various nationality groups with different, if not conflicting, territorial political loyalties. Quite a few of them emerged simultaneously with the pan-Indian identity, and some even predated it. Some of these nationalities were engaged in their own project of cultural hegemony, argues Barua. The colonial regime, besides making India into an integrated politico-territorial entity, also created new regional politico-territorial units incorporating willy-nilly more than one, in most cases several, such nationalities. This integration, however, was impelled by the administrative and economic motives, with the total exclusion of attempts to bind the territory with feelings of emotions and nationalism. On the contrary, in order to continue its exploitation unabated, the colonial administration took full recourse to the policy of divide and rule, thereby also hindering the ongoing process of nationality formation among the above-mentioned nationality groups. But colonial exploitation and repression, so universal throughout British India, had instilled in various communities within it a common sense of bondage as being deprived and marginalized. This in turn inspired them to fight united against the colonial regime. The fact that India long existed as a cultural and social entity despite all its internal variations helped. Although the constitution of leadership of the Indian freedom movement was not exactly all Indian in character, in that it did not have any noteworthy representation from the smaller or peripheral communities, not much opposition was raised against the former in view of the ultimate objective of the movement. Eric Hobsbawm thus very aptly describes India as a polity that grew out of anti-colonial movement. It is in the wake of this movement that the Indian nationalist leadership woke up to the idea of one Indian nation by incorporating the various ethnic and linguistic entities within the colonial state. The Indian nationalist leaders tried to carry out this objective after independence in the name of policy of nation building through its own project of cultural hegemony. However, some scholars point out that treating of Indian response to the British colonial rule under the unified title of nationalist movement is nothing but the rarefied reading of the movement, which is insensitive to the regional variations and is ideological in intent and character. Regional nationalist identities and linguistic states. Nevertheless, almost simultaneously to the independence of the country, demands came from various nationalities from its region for a greater recognition of their identity within the new dispensation of the state. Language became the mainstay of this new identity aspiration. It posed a new challenge to the nation-building exercise of the recently independent Indian state. The colonial state created territorial unions that were not based on any obvious principle except administrative convenience and quite accidental timing of conquest, argues Kaviraj. This practice, argues Kaviraj, says that subcolonial advantages for some linguistic groups simply because those were the first to receive colonial education and form the natural reservoir for personal for colonial administrative expansion. Resentment against this kind of subcolonial dominance was bound to find expression after independence. Movements for regional autonomy began soon after independence with a demand for the recognition of an Andhra state. The post-independence Indian state was initially unsympathetic to the demand for statehood based on distinct linguistic identity. Jawaharlal Nehru opposed a scenario for the fear of creating inward-looking states that would imperil the consolidation of Indian nationhood and even encourage separatism, argues Tillin. Political scientist Suvidita Kaviraj also holds that Nehru's opposition to linguistic states was due to the anxiety that more homogeneous regional units might lead to the weakening of the political imagination of the Indian nation. However, in the wake of pressing demands, the States Reorganization Commission 1956 recommended the reorganization of the states on linguistic and a number of new states were created, starting with the creation of a separate Andhra state from the erstwhile Madras state as a result of a very strong campaign launched in Andhra region in the early 1950s for the reorganization of the state boundaries along linguistic communities rather than administrative histories. In the subsequent years, more linguistic states were created in the South and West India. States were created for speakers of Kannada, spread into Karnataka, Malayalam, Kerala, Marathi, Maharashtra, and Gujarati, Gujarat, and later Punjab and Haryana were divided into two, although religion as well as language, Punjabi and Hindi, was at stake in the latter instance. Although the cultural foundation of India's regionally based sub-nationalism was the languages of the region, the problem with the northeast region of the country arises from the fact that the region has so many linguistic groups that it is not realistically possible to reorganize it on linguistic lines. Assam, the home of the largest linguistic community in the region, the Assamese, was for a very long time a separate British province which incorporated many areas like the district of Naga Hills, present Nagaland, Khasi and Jayantia Hills, present Meghalaya, and Luhasi Hills, present Mizoram. These areas after independence have been made into separate provinces not on the basis of linguistic principle. Rather, the guiding principles, singularly or collective, that led to the making of these provinces were religion, race, geographical and physical distinctiveness, beginning with the formation of separate province of Nagaland in 1963. Subsequently, states of Meghalaya and Mizoram were also created. However, the demands for separate states from different regions did not stop. Creation of Uttarakhand from Uttar Pradesh, creation of Jharkhand bifurcating Bihar and Chhattisgarh from Madhya Pradesh in the year 2000 was in response to such demands. Statehood demands for Vidarbha from Maharashtra, Bundelkhand from Uttar Pradesh and Madhya Pradesh have been continuing for quite long. There has been a demand for further division of Uttar Pradesh. Statehood demands for separate Gorkhaland bifurcating West Bengal borderland from Assam also have been there for quite some time. A number of statehood movements mentioned above, however, moved away from language-based identity assertion and made regional inequality as the basis of their demand. The most example of this is the creation of the new state of Telangana by buffeting Andhra Pradesh in 2014, although the demand can be traced back to the late 1960s. Further, as Tillon argues, some scholars state that such demands for the creation of new states have to be understood in the context of decentralization of political life and economic change in India. Rise in the politics of regionalism. Politics of regionalism in India can be traced back to the Dravidian identity assertion in Tamil Nadu. Interestingly, the DMK of Tamil Nadu at an early stage asserted its aim for an independent state for the Dravidians. Although they dropped this idea afterwards, they vehemently opposed a move of the central government to introduce Hindi as official language of Government of India in 1965, and was mainly their opposition which prompted the central government to continue with both Hindi and English as official languages of the Government of India. In April 1974, the DMK government brought in a resolution in the State Assembly urging the centre to accept the Raja Manar Committee recommendation on state autonomy and amend the Constitution of India to pave the way for a true federal system. Similarly, the Shiromani Akali in Punjab articulated their political, economic and cultural views in the Anandpur Sahib resolution in 1973. It clearly underscored that India is a federal and republican geographical entity of different languages, regions and cultures. It stated that in order to safeguard the fundamental rights of the religious and linguistic minorities to fulfill the demands of the democratic traditions and to pave way for the economic progress, it was imperative that Indian constitutional infrastructure should be given real federal shape by redefining the central state relations. Early 1980s also witnessed the emergence of some new political parties such as Telugu Desam Party in Andhra Pradesh, Assam Gana Parishad in Assam, asserting regional aspirations against the alleged domination of the central government. Gradually, the country also saw the emergence of political parties like Shiv Sena in Maharashtra, founded on anti-immigrant ideology. As Indians from one region have moved in far greater numbers to another region in the last couple of decades, such anti-immigrant ideology has spread to various other parts of India in recent times, posing questions about one Indian identity for all its citizens and nation-building exercise of the Indian nation. As Aloysius puts, Indian nationalism, instead of giving birth to one national society, seems to have delivered a whole litter of communities divided from one another in terms of language, religion, region and caste. Secessionist challenges. The regional nationalist assertion in India has not been confined only to the demand for the creation of linguistic states or for the fulfillment of other regional aspirations within the Indian nation state. The latter has had to face the challenges of secessionism from various regions. Starting with Naga insurgency in the northeastern region immediately after the independence, such secessionist movements have spread to other groups in the region such as Mizos, the Manipuri Metis, the tribal groups in Tripura and the Assamese. Since the early 1980s, the Khalistani insurgency in the state of Punjab assumed a serious turn. Similarly, separatist movement in Kashmir has been a continuous source of challenge to the Indian nation state. Although the Indian state has been negotiating with these movements by various means, sometimes with success, questions have also been raised about the fault lines that using of some of these means, especially military force and repressive laws, have unfolded. Conclusion. It is, however, to be noted that the Indian state has tried to address the question of diversity of the country in terms of various constitutional provisions for a number of groups and states. In fact, much before the independence of the country, the leadership of the anti-colonial freedom movement acknowledged its staggering diversity, which makes it impossible to imagine India in the frame of the Western nation states. Therefore, they adopted an inclusive approach to the future nation building in India, which was embedded in the phrase unity in diversity, emphasizing an underlying unity of the people of India despite the differences in language, culture, history and so on. After the independence of the country, the leadership of the freedom movement got this understanding enshrined in various provisions of the constitution. For example, backward groups and communities within the country have been accorded with various provisions to safeguard the political, cultural and economic interest. While the state of Jammu Kashmir, a Muslim majority state, was given a special constitutional status under Article 370, several states in the northeastern India, inhabited by a majority of tribal population, have also been given special constitutional status where the traditional customary laws of the tribal groups often get precedence over the provisions of the Indian constitution. Similarly, many tribal communities which have not been given separate states have been given special status under the 5th and 6th schedules of the constitution. This is how the Indian state has accommodated not only regional aspirations but also aspirations of the minorities and disadvantaged groups. Jaffelot argues, despite a more inclusive constitutional mandate, the Indian state often shows a tendency to engage in a project of cultural homogenization in the mold of dominant Hindi-Hindu culture. seeking to establish a culturally more uniform nation state. Women also contends, the central issue of nation building in India revolves around the persistent tension between Hindi-speaking twice-born Hindus who define themselves as the norm setters and the value givers, the cultural mainstream, and a multiplicity of other primordial collectivities occupying the periphery of the system, depending upon the positioning in the socio-cultural space of India. Such a tendency of privileging one set of language, culture, religion, mainly belonging to the politically and demographically dominant North India, over others posed to marginalize language, culture, religion of other regions as well as minority communities. In fact, within the followers of Hinduism too, there have been serious and many regional variations in terms of the rituals, customs and food habits. In a multicultural, multilinguistic, multireligious society like India, such attempts at homogenization have thus generated apprehensions among the communities which are at the receiving end of such homogenization projects. The attempt of Government of India to introduce Hindi as official language of India, for example, has faced repeated resistance time and again. The anti-Hindi agitations of 1965 forced the central government to abandon its efforts to introduce Hindi as the only official language of the country and to continue with English as the other official language. Further, the Indian center is enormously strong. In constitutional terms itself, India is a union of states. The Indian polity was designed professly to keep the newly independent nation state with a large number of ethnic identities politically and territorially intact. But the power of the center vis-a-vis the states kept on growing, far exceeding the original constitutional sanction. Such centralizing tendencies have given rise to politics of regionalism in different parts of India. Nevertheless, it is to be noted that many of these regional or sub-national aspirations and movements, often steered by the interest of the regional elites, have been addressed by the Indian state within the broader framework of the Indian nation state. However, for a long-term solution to the conflict between the nation-building project of the Indian nation state and the aspirations of smaller nationalities and communities, scholars have argued for the creation of a federal state sensitive to the identities and aspirations of various groups within it. Mishra, for example, advocates greater decentralization of powers and a radical restructuring of a center-state relations as a solution to the problem. Sanjeev Barua, on the other hand, argues for a shift in the policy of the Indian state from nation-building to that of federation-building. Referring to the recurrent secessionist movements in the northeastern region of India, he says, only a bold new project of genuine federation building that takes a complex multinational history seriously and framed as an alternative to nation building can become a viable alternative to independentist thought that captures the heart and minds of so many young people in India's troubled northeast. Similar recommendations were made by the Sakarya Commission, constituted by Government of India, which submitted its report on the center-state relation in India in 1988. But these recommendations are yet to see implementation. There is no gainsaying that how the Indian state negotiates between its concern about the unity and security of the Indian nation and rising aspirations of a large number of nationalities within its territorial boundary, which largely shaped the nature of Indian nation and nationalism in the times to come. Summary. In the above module, we have discussed the concepts of nation and related concepts such as nation-state, nationality, nationalism and nation-building. A nation is often confused with ethnic group and state. While a people sharing common myths, language, customs, history, religion may constitute an ethnic group to become a nation, it must have an association with the homeland, real or imagined. The state, on the other hand, is a legally constituted institution. While territory is common to both, there is a crucial difference between national territory and state territory in that the former is a moral and the latter is a legal entity. The Indian state is constituted by many groups and nationalities. Some of these preceded and some emerged simultaneously to the Indian nation which grew out of the colonial rule in India. The anti-colonial rule gave rise to the idea of Indian nation and nationalism which went on to inform the nation-building exercise of post-independent Indian state. Although the Indian constitution offers a more inclusive mandate with regard to Indian nation building, critics argue that Indian state have been engaged in a project of cultural homogenization in the mold of dominant culture seeking to establish a culturally more uniform nation state. This has stood in the way of political, economic and cultural aspirations of the smaller nationalities and other minorities, prompting different kinds of protest and assertions among them. After discussing the module on nation, nation building and nationalism in India, one could see that as students of sociology, the major lesson that we could take away from this module is that while the Indian state has achieved some success in addressing some of these issues and concern, the political, economic and cultural aspirations of the smaller nationalities problems still remain. And therefore, it calls for a more inclusive, more sound and more grounded development policy from that of the Indian state. Thank you.